What's going on, High Springs? This is Leo Love. We're here with Mayor Ed Braddy of Gainesville, who's running for re-election. And we're sitting down wanting to talk to him. Good afternoon, Mr. Mayor. Welcome to our station.
Well, good afternoon. Thank you for having me. Glad to be here.
Well, it's an honor to have you. I'd like to talk to you about your platform immediately on what have you done in this last term and what you've been trying to accomplish in the next term.
Excellent. Well, and of course, we do have an election coming up in Gainesville. The election is March 15th, but I'd point out that early voting actually begins March 4th on Friday and runs for about a week. And then, of course, some people are already turning in their absentee ballots. So the campaign season is in full swing and racing to a close here. So appreciate the opportunity to reach out to any of your listeners in Gainesville. But I'm running for re-election really because I think my record as mayor justifies it. When I took office 3 years ago, I think, you know, we really have to think back to how it was, the condition the city was in, the direction it was going in, and what has really amounted to, I think, a pretty impressive reversal of fortune in putting things in the right direction. The biggest challenge has been, of course, the GRU bills and the consequences of the biomass contract and the biomass plan as it came online. That's something I inherited in 2013. Interestingly enough, my principal opponent, Lauren Poe, was a commissioner who voted in favor of the contract. He ratified the contract way back in 2009. We're just now feeling the consequences of it. So tackling that has been the biggest challenge as mayor that I've had. It unfortunately pushed our rates to among the highest in the state. But where we're at right now is we've pretty much stopped the rate escalation. So now we're trying to start bringing those bills down, and I would hate for us to go back to the way it was. So I certainly want to, you know, keep things going in the right direction on that, even if we know right now there's still a lot of pain when one looks at their GRU bill. But we're starting to turn the corner on that. It's taken some time. So that's one of the main reasons that I ran for election in 2013 and then I'm running for re-election, is to keep things going. On other fronts, you know, we have a city. We have a city where people want opportunities, they want jobs, they want a chance to start their own business. So that's another thing I'm very proud of having tackled head on. I started a small business task force to help the small businesses sort of get a foothold. You know, oftentimes people don't realize just how complicated city processes can be. So I worked to help that become a little easier to navigate. I launched a Blue Ribbon Committee on Economic Competitiveness because what we determined is it is not enough just to change regulations or change the procedures. It's an attitude adjustment that's needed at City Hall. And so we've really worked hard, I think, to get us to a culture of yes, how can we help you, as opposed to a culture of no. And that's required moving some personnel around, as well as changing the way we do business. So those are all the things that are starting to gel at this time, and I'm proud of these accomplishments and certainly would like to continue going forward.
Now, you say that the GRU bills are working to bring them down right now?
Oh, yes. And we've made some room. It's not all that visible, but in January, we actually lowered the fuel adjustment rate by about 6.5%. Again, that's not monumental, but I think the significance of that for your listeners is that that was the first rate decrease of any kind we've had. When I took office in 2013, not only did we already have, were we already locked into a contract that obligates us to pay over $70 million a year in fixed costs, regardless of if we use any power or not, we have to pay that, and then we have to pay additional fuel costs on top of that. I mean, this is how bad the contract is. Not only that, the budget that had been adopted by the previous mayor and commissioners, including Commissioner Lauren Poe at the time, had projected rate increases every year for the remainder of the decade.
Wow.
That part we have stopped. We didn't stop the initial escalation. Like I said, that was unfortunately sort of beyond our control. But the budget we adopted this fiscal year had no budgeted increases. And then, like I said, in January, we offered our first rate reduction and fuel adjustment. Again, for someone who's looking at their bill, I get it. I'm a dad. I know what it's like to look at that utility bill and say, oh my gosh, how did it get to, you know, be this high? But my point is, it was actually projected to be much higher. We've leveled it off, and now we're going to try and start bringing it down. And when I talk about personnel changes, one of the things I did accomplish in year one was the dismissal of the general manager who negotiated the contract. We now have a new GM. He brings a strong financial background. And again, just to give you and your listeners an idea of how bad it was, not only did we have bad leadership negotiating the contract in the city commission at the time that was indifferent to the impact on cost, but we lost our CFO and our comptroller. Okay. Our two top financial people at the utility resigned in large part because of what was going on. So not only did we have bills to deal with, we had some serious personnel issues. So I would like to think that I brought some stability to that, some really smart leadership now that they're finally addressing some of these financial problems. And we're in a much stronger financial position today to start lowering bills. In fact, right now, as we speak, the biomass plant is in what's called cold standby. We're not producing any power from it, so we're not obligated to pay for it. That is saving us about $50,000 a day. Wow. That gives you an idea of how monumental these costs are. $50,000 a day we're saving, which is why we can reduce that fuel adjustment charge a bit. We're still on the hook, though, for the $70+ million that we have to pay every year as a consequence of that of the contract. So, again, this is something Lauren Poe voted to ratify. We are working hard now to try and find ways to get some value out of there for customers. We're experiencing some successes. We got a lot more to go, so I hope to continue as mayor because we are finally getting that moving in the right direction.
Okay. Do you have any idea when the consumer might see it?
When the consumer will see it? Well, like I said, we do think we can add additional rate reductions to the fuel adjustment piece of the bill in the coming months. Again, because of how we're sort of playing hardball with Breck, which is the company that owns the biomass plant. So the general manager is pretty confident that in the months ahead we can produce some additional savings that will, again, be realized in an actual rate reduction.
Okay. Tell me about the unemployment rate.
Mm-hmm. So Gainesville is an interesting city because it's a college town, and this may be one of the most frustrating things for a lot of people. Our unemployment rate is actually very low. It's among the lowest in the state. But our underemployment rate is far too high. And that's something you see happen in a lot of college towns. A lot of college towns, you have a lot of service industry jobs that are easy to fill. You can always get them filled, and that's why you can get a rate that's pretty low. But in terms of underemployment, what that addresses is, do we have the quality of jobs that's fit for the caliber or the talent of the people we have here? And that's where we're unfortunately, that rate's too high.
Right.
So what we have to do is we have to attract the type of businesses that produce the jobs that offer really good gainful employment. Again, most kids, most young folks growing up, they can find a service job that'll pay them a wage to get started, but you can't raise a family on it. You can't bank a living. So that's where we tackle the underemployment. So we're working with, and we have a really strong partnership. Like, again, another thing I'm pretty proud of is I'd say our partnerships with community stakeholders are probably stronger now than they've ever been. And one of those is the Chamber of Commerce and our ability to try and attract new businesses and new jobs that can create higher paying wages for our citizens. And then the other piece of that is spirit of entrepreneurship.
Right.
It's not enough that, you know, I mean, I truly believe that people of all different backgrounds and all walks of life, they can be just as aspirational as the engineering nerd at UF, you know, who has the next great idea, you know, whatever. So we need all kinds of economic activity. And I've worked closely with other partners like the Gainesville Housing Authority. They have an excellent little entrepreneurial program for their own residents. And part of the Small Business Task Force also was to, you know, help people achieve their dreams. And I've created the city's first ever, it's a committee on minority-owned and minority-oriented businesses. And the purpose of that is, it goes back to a conversation that I've heard for decades, which is that we don't give enough attention to East Gainesville, that we see a lot of growth and activity in Western Gainesville and Western Alachua County, but East Gainesville seems to get left behind. And of course, that is a high proportion of people in East Gainesville are minorities. And so I just want to address it head on. So we created a whole committee that is exclusively focusing on how we can bring more opportunities to minority-owned and minority-oriented businesses and services. And I think that's going to start to take off too. We've, you know, it's not just so it's not just a geographical location, because it can be all over the city where people may want to start a business or develop a service. But just historically, we know that there seems to be that there just haven't been as many opportunities as you see in other parts of town.
Right, you're absolutely right. Now, East Gainesville, like you mentioned before, is a little bit underdeveloped. The incorporation is pretty low there. So now I hear about this Plum Creek, and everybody's working to bring Plum Creek online. Give me a little bit of information on Plum Creek.
Yeah, I can only give you a little too, because it's mostly a county matter, and actually it was voted down just yesterday, 3-2, against transmitting their sector plan to Tallahassee for further review. So I would assume that means it's on hold for at least a 12-month period. They can come back with another plan. But what I heard about it is that it would provide essentially the development of another large economic activity center that would allow some research spinoff for the university, some private industry, and thus the consequential jobs that would follow, as well as some residential development in that area. It was not plan for the city limits of Gainesville. It would be to the east of Gainesville city limits, but the spillover or residual benefits from it, we believe, would have worked its way into Gainesville. But even though that's on hold, I mean, one of the things of one of the challenges of being the mayor and the leadership is you can't just put all your eggs in one basket. So we're already working on, I mean, we've already had contingency plans. We've resurrected the Hatchet Creek proposal, which went back, again, almost a decade. It's a piece of land, tract of land out by the Gainesville Regional Airport that got shot down a few times, and we've kept working with the developer to try and get his plan modified so that there wouldn't be objections from the airport. They had concerns over the noise cone that might trigger some, you know, objections should the project be built. So we've actually worked through a lot of that, and that now is moving forward. And part of that would have some economic activity areas on a much smaller scale, but it would allow for some housing as well as some activity centers there. We've redeveloped, or we are redeveloping, the former Kennedy home site along the Hawthorne Road corridor.
Right.
And that would that has a whole new marketing strategy to promote commercial activity and mixed use development. And then I can tell you, just today, I met with a guy who's trying to work out a deal with Golden Corral to bring a Golden Corral to a site on the Waldo Road corridor. So I've participated now in several meetings, including meetings with corporate executives from Golden Corral. They've actually come to Gainesville and looked at our numbers, and it's all a numbers game when it comes to siting the restaurant. And I had a follow-up this morning and later this afternoon, and we were site locating some spots, and we're pushing that forward. And then again, these are things, you know, honestly, are painfully slow. As mayor, someone who's running for re-election, I wish it could happen, you know, yesterday, but they take time. They take time to put these large deals together.
Right, I understand that. But when you're talking about developing East Gainesville, when you talk about that, I see, I guess my question is, if you're developing East Gainesville, you bring these technical jobs into Gainesville, how would it benefit the people on the east side of Gainesville?
Right. So, first of all, I don't believe it should only be the high-tech jobs. It
should be
all kinds of economic activity. But to that point, I think we are developing the talent. We have it's not just the university in Santa Fe that can produce talent in a student. I think our K-12 system can too. And with the emphasis that the new school board superintendent is putting into what's called STEM education, science, technology, education, and math, I think the kids that we are graduating out of Gainesville high schools all over the place will have the skill set for the technical type of jobs. And in fact, one of the things I've done again as mayor is I partnered a group called the Gainesville Dev Academy, Gainesville Development Academy. They specialize in all this stuff I have no clue about with computers, like coding and, you know, how to develop apps and all that stuff. And they are actually going to accept a graduate of the Reichert House, which is a special project of the city of Gainesville. It's one of the city's programs to help at-risk youth, disproportionately minority youth. And so we're going to make sure at least one of them every year goes into the Dev Academy to help them develop even further the skill set for immediate high-paying job. So my goal has always been to fully incorporate all four corners of the city, east, west, north, and south, into this innovation culture. But to be clear, I don't think everything has to be about the innovation, tech-heavy parts of the economy. I think there are entrepreneurs in all walks of life who can find meaningful and gainful employment and can provide jobs to others that are also meaningful and gainful, that cover all sectors of the economy.
All right. We're here with Gainesville Mayor Ed Braddy, and we're going to take a break right now, and we'll come back later. We'll talk about what he plans to do in his new election. If real, that's connected. You're listening to WUBA 88.1.
Braddy, talking about his re-election, Mayor Ed Braddy. Mr. Mayor, what do you plan to do on the second half? If you were re-elected tomorrow, what would you do?
Yeah, I'd take the kids fishing. We'd get out of town for a break. But like I said at the beginning, I want to continue what we're doing, but continuing doesn't mean maintain the status quo. It means getting Gainesville to a different level. One of the themes I've had is that Gainesville is in the middle of a renewal, but we're not renewed. You know, we still have ways to go. We have stopped the bleeding at the utility, but the bills are still too high. So one of the targets we've set is we have a goal to have our utility bills somewhere in the middle of the pack in terms of where the state is. Right now we're at the high end. We're at the high end both for residents, but also for commercial, for businesses. So to be competitive, we've got to get our rates down somewhere toward the middle. That's a goal. We need to do more with our transportation system. You know, again, you know, I gave sort of the way it was on the matters affecting our energy policy and our utility at the beginning, but also consider the transportation policy. The city commission was narrowing roads, removing the two lanes from Northwest 8th Avenue, and they had on the table projected expenses for $128 million streetcar, $400 million for bus rapid transit and stuff like that. So they really just, I think, had a transportation vision that was detached from reality.
Right.
I mean, our general government budget that includes police and fire and all that is less than $128 million, and that's what they want to spend on a streetcar downtown. So that shows you just how bad it was. Well, we restored, under my leadership, 8th Avenue to four lanes.
Right.
We have increased the amount of money we allot to road resurfacing from about $300,000 to over $2 million. We've built more sidewalks and bike paths, and we've done things like that. But we're completely reconstructing Southeast 4th Street, which runs from downtown to where Williston Road curves around and becomes Waldo Road. So we're making just some good infrastructure improvements that I think our citizens will start to see and realize that, you know, yeah, they're finally paving roads like they're supposed to.
Right.
So we're doing some of those infrastructure improvements. I've led some initiatives on street lighting at night to provide better safety. We walk through the Duval neighborhood, which is off of Waldo Road and 8th and Northeast 8th Avenue, and we're planning some improvements. I've budgeted some additional monies for that. So to me, part of the main thing of running a city well is that you do the basics well. You sort of take care of the fundamental parts, law enforcement, public safety. One of the things I think is very concerning to me as a mayor, and probably many of your listeners, is you look around the country and you see racial tensions getting worse, and you see the interaction with law enforcement sometimes leading to very just catastrophic outcomes.
Right.
I wanted to be proactive on that. I think we have a great police force. I think we have a great police chief. But I know that you can have, out of 100 events, 99 can go very well, but one of them can, you know, goes wrong and the CNN trucks show up
right,
on your doorstep
right.
tomorrow.
Well, I have to tell you, I cook for the Gainesville Police Department from time to time. I have my favorite barbecue sandwich that I make, and I cook up a big rack of lamb and bring it over and drop it off. And that's just to show my appreciation for what they do. I understand that things can go wrong in the city, but we have to also realize that those guys are putting their life on the line every day.
And did I tell you the mayor's wife loves lamb? just saying, you know, it might be.
I'll keep that in mind.
Keep that in mind. But anyway, yeah, they do great work. But we also know we can always do better. We know that the expectations are to do better. So in that spirit, I created the Mayor's Community Response Council. It is a broad-based group of citizens from many different backgrounds who represent different organizations. And they had met every few months and as a subcommittee every month for over a year to talk about policing matters, and in particular how they interact with minority youth and better ways to do it. And we just now have some recommendations that we received from them. So again, what do I want to do in the second term if reelected? Fulfill those recommendations. We have 9 recommendations. The police are looking at how they can incorporate that into practices and policies, and actually we're ahead of the curve on a lot of it, so something to be very proud of. But it should start yielding better results. And to the police chief's credit, he has already started on his own to really address things like the school. It's called the school to prison pipeline and things like that. I participated in activities. We helped support opening 3 free Wi-Fi areas in East Gainesville to help bridge the digital divide, and just trying to come up with programmatic activities for the kids so that they stay out of trouble,
right.
And we can proudly say that we have reduced the number of minority youth arrested by 44% between 2014 and 2015. That's a stunning number, but it didn't happen by accident. But that's the police chief. That's the style of policing we do, where we engage. We try to engage young folks early before they get in trouble, and then depending on the type of offense. You know, I don't think anyone wants someone to be stained with a permanent record.
Exactly.
So depending on the offense, we're working out some programs to help wipe that clean and give them another chance.
Okay. Now, I'd like to thank that one police officer did with the kids playing basketball.
Oh, yeah.
I think that was a fantastic thing to do, and he handled it very well.
Yes. Yes, he's Basketball Cop is his name. He's actually got a Facebook identity. And again, to his credit, Officer Bobby White is his name. And to his credit, he has started a foundation, and his vision, his goal, is to take this message across Gainesville and help build basketball courts and things like that for kids in all of the different neighborhoods, and then maybe even help it go national, you know. But it is a style of policing. Something the police chief said that really stuck with me is he said, you know, police officers, they can either be warriors or they can be guardians.
Exactly.
And sometimes, depending on the circumstance, maybe you have to be the warrior, and others maybe not. But the mindset, whenever they come across an event like Officer White had, where there's a complaint about kids being noisy in the street, and he comes up and what they're doing, well, they're playing basketball.
Exactly.
So they're engaged in a productive, healthy activity. And so instead of having the warrior mindset and said, hey, you know, you're really upsetting your neighbors and we have a code here that says this, he just shot basketball with them for a while, engaged them as people, showed respect for them. They showed respect for him, except for his jump shot.
Yeah.
And then at the end, he just said, look, guys, y'all keep having fun. Can you just keep it down a little bit? And they agreed. Isn't it amazing how life works like that?
And I think that was the best approach that we possibly ever could have had. Man, we're going to take a break, and we're going to play a song, and we'll come back and kind of wrap it up just a little bit. I appreciate you having me.
I'm glad to be here.
We're here live with Mayor Ed Braddy on WUBA 88.1. This is Leo Love inside, hanging out with you. I'll tell you what. Listeners, we are having a great time here in the studio talking to Mayor Ed Braddy, who's running for re-election, and that election is coming up on the 15th of this month.
Right, that's right. So, yeah, hope your listeners like what they hear. you know, my website, there's more information there. It's at mayor4gainesville.com, mayor4gainesville.com. And you find more information and contact information if any of your listeners want to reach out to me. We're doing our part. We have a great campaign team trying to reach out to as many voters as we can, and hope we can earn their support for a second term.
Well, that's certainly hope so as well, Mr. Mayor. We, you know, here at WUBA, we don't endorse any candidate. We're neutral in this thing. Mm-hmm. But from what I've seen so far, I think it's a great, that you have been doing a great job in the city. One thing that you did talk about in your last State of the City address were young people who were doing things in the city.
Right.
And I think that was great to recognize those young people who are doing things in the city, because we do have a lot of young people who are doing great things within our cities.
Absolutely. I was very proud to single out some folks. A young man, Lamont Wallace, who was an award winner for an essay on Martin Luther King Day, and his aspirations as a young, just a young person. And hopefully he'll stay a member of our community and have a great impact. And then I recognize someone else, and I actually referenced this earlier, an entrepreneurial program started at the Housing Authority. So it wasn't one of those tech-savvy things. And I recognize a young lady there. Her name was Tracy Carroll, and she started her own business. So she goes from a resident of the Housing Authority. And you know, many people think there's not many aspirations there. But, you know, she got an opportunity, and she took advantage of it. So I love it when I can recognize so many talents. You know, we have the great phrase that we have throughout America's history is the pursuit of happiness. But right. I always like to think of, I always add an S to pursuit. It should be plural, pursuits of happiness. We all have different goals and dreams and visions and experiences, and we've made different life choices, and some had greater barriers and others didn't, and all that stuff. So it's kind of silly to think we all have just one pursuit. You know, we have many pursuits, and I think if Gainesville can become a city of opportunity, then it is one where you get to define happiness, and then you get to pursue it. And the city is there to help facilitate that, not to control it, not to inhibit it, but to say, okay, you want to run your own cleaning business, we can help. You know, you want to start your own music company, we can help. You want to open up a restaurant, we can help.
Now, is there an age limit on entrepreneurs?
Oh no, they start early, you know, and it's actually quite disgusting when you hear some young kid who has this brilliant idea and they're already making money, and you go, why did I think of that?
Right.
You know, one of the things I did, I'm very proud to brag on, is I helped bring Uber, which is this ride-sharing service, to Gainesville. We redid the regulations. But I actually flew out to San Francisco because I had this, you know, we think of ourselves as a college town, but we actually have a growing senior population.
Exactly.
And seniors have their own transportation needs and their own transportation challenges. So realizing that it would be cost prohibitive to just get a bunch of buses and a bunch of bus stops for seniors who probably wouldn't use them much anyway, I thought of what if the city could sponsor a program where we provided subsidized rides to seniors through Uber. So I fly out to San Francisco and I meet with their senior executives, and I swear to God, they're all like 22 years old. It's absolutely disgusting. But they agreed, and so we actually here in Gainesville have the nation's first program. It's called Freedom in Motion, and any senior in the city of Gainesville can receive a Uber ride to wherever they need to go, and the maximum copay is $5, anywhere from $0 to $5. We partnered with Elder Care of Alachua County. They're administering it. The city of Gainesville put in the money. My goal for second terms is expanding that. It's great for seniors, but it should also be something we make available to the disabled, and it should, and quite frankly, in places where we cannot provide reliable transit, we should make something like that available too. Some type of mobility voucher where you can empower the individual to get the mobility they need so they can get to their job, they can go see their kids play ball, they can go to, you know, the workout place or anything like that.
Okay. Now, speaking of Lamont Wallace.
Okay.
He has been invited to down on the boat in Australia because of his athletic talents.
Really?
Yes. He was invited. He extended the invitation and working on getting it there.
How about that?
I think that would be a great opportunity for him, as well as a great life experience. Open up doors for him and he would continue on. under the direction of his mom and pop.
Those people must be very proud, whoever they are.
I'm sure they are. I'm sure they are. But Mr. Mayor, let me ask you now. You recently got married.
Yes, I did.
You kept them a secret?
Well, we kind of just, it was a rather spontaneous thing. My bride, Charmaine, and I have been together for a while. You know, like probably any couples on and off and up and down and everything, but she's a good woman, and we decided in December, we just felt the time was right, and we didn't announce it to anyone. In fact, we went to my parents' house. My mom and dad live here in Gainesville, and they retired here. And we went to them the day after Christmas, and we said, by the way, we're going to the beach tomorrow to get married, and if you want to come along, you can.
Okay.
We swung by and picked up our kids and told them we had a surprise, and then we drove out there, and we had a good friend who's a judge, and he married us on Crescent Beach.
All right. Well, Mr. Mayor, when you get home, there's your name. Said hi here.
Sure will.
And I thank you for stopping by the studios and talking with us. And I'm just, you know, excited for you. And
glad to be here.
Your campaign will go well for you. And we're not beating anybody up.
Nope.
We've been just here.
We got a great message. We have a great record. We have a great message for the future. And I do hope your listeners like what they hear. And I hope they'll support Ed Braddy on March 15th. And I hope they'll pass the word.
Well, here's the word, High Spring, Gainesville, and surrounding areas. You tell a friend to tell a friend. We're going to broadcast this thing live on podcast, and we'll continue to do our best to serve your community. From around the country, around the world, around the block.
This is Ed Braddy. I'm running for re-election as mayor on Tuesday, March 15th, and I approve this message.